Karan Jetley Live.
Hi guys, welcome to my channel, and in this video we are going to discuss multiprocessor operating system types. So guys, for the full video, all of you stay tuned. So guys, when it comes to multiprocessor operating system, so we have three main categories for multiprocessor operating system. The first category is each CPU has its own operating system. So all of you are aware, in multiprocessor environment, what we have different CPUs which are connected to each other using a bus. So in that case, each CPU has its own operating system. So the second type which comes is master-slave multiprocessors. And the third type which comes is symmetric multiprocessors. So when we talk about multiprocessor operating system, we have three main categories. One is each has its own operating system. Another category is master-slave type operating system. And third one is symmetric multiprocessor. Now we will discuss each of them in detail, one by one. So guys, the first type in which each CPU has its own operating system, in that arrangement, what is happening? So we have different CPUs. For example, this is CPU 1, then we have CPU 2, then we have CPU 3, and we have CPU 4. So all of them are connected to each other using a bus. And here we have something called as memory. And they are sharing a memory also with the help of bus. So these are the different CPUs, and this is our memory. Now here, CPU 1, it has its own private operating system. It has its own operating system. This has its own operating system. This has its own operating system, and all of them, they have their own operating system. And the memory which is shared by them is also divided into four different parts. One memory is for CPU 1, another part is for CPU 2, another part is for CPU 3, and so on. Now guys, in this case, the memory which is meant for CPU 1 is only used by CPU 1. It cannot be shared by the memory for CPU 2. Okay, so here all the CPUs, they have their own private operating system, and the memory is also divided into, in this case, four parts, and each memory is accessible by that particular operating system for which it is meant to be. Means this memory cannot be accessed by any other CPU. Okay, so CPU 1 has its own operating system, and it has its own private memory. Okay, and CPU 2 has its own operating system, and this memory belongs to CPU 2. CPU 3 has operating system, and this is the memory, and so on. This is for CPU number 4. Now, this is the approach in which all the CPUs, they have their own operating systems. Now in this case, if a user is logged in into CPU 1, then all the processes of user will be executed by CPU 1 only. So those processors cannot be transferred to CPU 2, 3 or 4. So if user is logged into CPU 2, then all the user processes will be handled by the CPU number 2. Okay, so the drawback of this approach is, now there are chances if we have more user logged in CPU 1 and we have less number of users logged in CPU 2. So then CPU 1 will be overloaded and CPU 2 will be underloaded. Okay, so there is no balancing between the load. So this is the main drawback of this operating system. And same thing applies to the memory. For example, if CPU 1 has consumed all the memory and the memory allocated to CPU 2 is available, so since it cannot be shared, so in case CPU 1 needs some memory, it cannot get a memory from the memory space of CPU 2. So this is the drawback of this approach. Okay, so what we have in this arrangement is all the CPUs, they have their separate operating system, and the memory is also divided into separate four spaces, and which are dedicated to each operating system, to each CPU. And one CPU cannot access the memory allocated to another CPU. Okay. Now, in this case, in some cases, some CPUs can be overloaded and some CPUs can be underloaded. Okay. And the other drawback is, if CPU 1 has utilized all his memory, in case he needs any memory, so the memories which are allocated to other CPUs cannot be assigned to this. So guys, this was the first approach, in which each CPU has its own operating system. Now we will discuss the second approach. So guys, the second operating system type is called as master-slave multiprocessor. In this, again, we have four CPUs, CPU 1, 2 and 3. So in this case, one of the CPU, it runs the operating system, and rest other CPUs, they run the user processors. In this case, CPU 1 is the master and it runs the operating system. Wherever CPU 2, 3 and 4, they are the slaves. They do not run the operating system, but they run the user processors. Now, in case any of the CPU needs to run some system call, so that call is directed to CPU 1, which is the master, and it will handle the system calls, and rest others, they will handle the user processors. Okay. And if master CPU is free after handling all the system calls, then it can also run the user process. It can also run the user process if it is idle or if it is free after finishing all the operating system work. So this type of arrangement is called as master slave multiprocessor. In this, we have one master which runs the operating system and it handles all the system calls, and we have others which are slaves and they request the master to handle all the system calls, and then they themselves, they handle all the user processors, and this arrangement is called as master slave multiprocessors. So guys, the third and the last type is symmetric multiprocessors. Okay. So guys, in this approach is also similar to master slave, but the difference is, in this, there is no master. Okay. All the CPUs are masters and they all are slaves. Means all the CPUs, they can run the user processors. Means one can run the user process. Two can also run the user process. Three can also run. And they all can run the operating system. Okay. So they all can act as master and they all can act as slave. Okay. So if CPU 1 needs, so it can run its own operating system and it can run its user process. Okay. If CPU wants, it will run the user process. In case it needs any service from the operating system, it has its own copy of the operating system and it can run that operating system. So all the CPUs in this are masters and all the CPUs in this are also slaves. Now this is the approach which is normally used these days. Okay. So where all the CPUs have their own copy of the operating system. Okay. And they also run the user process, and whenever they need to run any system call, so they can have their copy of operating system and they can run the system call. Okay, now the main drawback of this approach is, so if one operating CPU 1, it decides to run a system call, and at the same time CPU 2 also decides to run the same system call, so then there is a conflict. Or if a one operating system accesses the some memory location and at the same time the operating system in CPU 2 also tries to access the same memory location, then again there is a conflict. To overcome this problem, in this approach they have something called as locks. So what is the advantage of using locks? The locks, they ensure that these operating system will run in mutually exclusive fashion. By mutually exclusive fashion, I mean they, one of the operating system will run at one time. So two operating systems cannot run at the same time. So any operating system which wants to make a system call must acquire the lock first. When it has the lock, then it will run the system call. And in case other operating system wants to run a system call, it must wait for the lock to become free. So at a time, only one operating system can make a system call with the help of locks. So in this approach, we can view our operating system as a large critical section. Okay, and any CPU which wants to run that critical section should acquire a lock on that critical section. So guys, this approach is called as symmetric multiprocessor. Okay, again guys, I hope you understand all the different types of multiprocessor operating systems. So I'll be uploading more and more lectures related to advanced operating systems and other concepts of IT. Okay, so if you like our videos, please subscribe to my channel. All of you, thanks for watching, and all of you stay tuned.